Hello, space fans, and welcome to another edition of Space Fan News. This week, astronomers at the European Southern Observatory are getting ready for Juno's arrival to Jupiter on July 4th. The Indian Space Research Agency makes history by launching a record 20 satellites into space at once. And China launches its next generation of booster rockets designed to carry large payloads into low Earth orbit. As I've reported many times over the last few months, NASA's Juno mission is expected to arrive at Jupiter this July 4 weekend after a five-year jaunt to the gas giant. Now, in preparation for Juno's arrival, astronomers using ESO's Very Large Telescope have obtained spectacular new infrared images of Jupiter. They are part of a campaign to create high-resolution maps of the giant planet. These observations will inform the work to be undertaken by Juno over the coming months, helping astronomers to better understand the gas giant ahead of Juno's close encounters. Now, these infrared images were taken with the VLT VISIR instrument, which stands for VLT Imager and Spectrometer for the Mid-Infrared. Nothing like an acronym within an acronym. And they are part of a focused effort to improve understanding of Jupiter's atmosphere prior to the arrival of Juno this weekend. Now, according to astronomers, these maps will help set the scene for what Juno will witness in the coming months. Observations at different wavelengths across the infrared spectrum allow us to piece together a three-dimensional picture of how energy and material are transported upwards through the atmosphere. Now, observing infrared wavelengths from ground-based telescopes is very challenging due to water vapor in our atmosphere, which blocks out very key parts of the spectrum. And getting clear, high-resolution images at this wavelength is even tougher. These observations are usually made in space with telescopes like Spitzer, Hubble, Herschel, and in the future, the James Webb Space Telescope, which is all infrared. But astronomers using VISIR on the VLT did something very clever, and they employed a technique that amateur astronomers have been using for a very long time now to reduce atmospheric effects on their images from their backyard. What they did was they took thousands and thousands of very high cadence, very short exposure images on VISIR, and they threw away all the ones that were blurry and fuzzy due to the atmosphere. Then they took the thousands that were left over that were still clear and unblurry and added them together in a process known as stacking. And the resulting image is a clear, high-resolution image with most of the atmospheric blurring gone. Now, these astronomers were calling this the lucky technique, but I've always called it the poor man's adaptive optics. Amateur astronomers have been using this for a long time as a way to reduce or remove the effects of a blurry or churning atmosphere. And in fact, the VLT astronomers got help from amateurs for this survey. As they were looking at Jupiter using VISIR and getting these short exposures, amateurs were doing the same thing with their telescopes in the optical wavelengths in their backyard. Now here's an example, the infrared images from VISIR and the stacked images from amateurs in the optical wavelengths. Pretty impressive, huh? I love it when amateurs and professionals combine forces. Now these high-resolution IR maps of Jupiter's upper atmosphere will help Juno when it looks underneath the upper cloud tops of the Jovian planet to see what's under there. Now this should be an exciting mission, and I've been looking forward to it for years now. And of course, I will be there to walk you through it. Now Juno arrives on July 4th, and it will begin taking data almost immediately. It's scheduled to take data for over 20 months over the course of 37 close approaches. Now if you'd like to learn more about it, just watch last week's SFN where I went into a little bit of detail over it. Next, the nation of India has much to celebrate this month as they set a new record for the total number of satellites put into orbit during one launch. ISRO, or the Indian Space Research Organization, is trying to get into the "we can launch things into space cheaply" game too and compete with SpaceX. Over the past few years, ISRO has gained a reputation for frugality in space, especially since many of their missions are successful despite all the cost cutting. For example, in 2014, ISRO sent an unmanned rocket to Mars that cost only $73 million. In total, that was all of it. Meanwhile, NASA's MAVEN mission, which is the closest comparison to the India's rocket mission, cost over $671 million. Well, this month, ISRO put a record 20 satellites into space all at one time, beating its old record of 10 satellites in 2008. And by record, I mean a record for India. This isn't the most ever launched. NASA launched 29 satellites in 2013, and Russia sent up 37 all at once in 2015. Still though, for ISRO, this is a huge milestone because this successful mission takes them close to the delivery rate of both NASA and the Russian Federal Space Agency, and it makes them a powerful competitor in the global space market. Now, out of the 20 satellites, 17 were commercial and are used by companies to help us do things like get better TV signals and weather forecasts, and 13 of those satellites were from U.S.-based companies. But the main cargo was ISRO's 725-kilogram, or about a 1,600-pound, CARTOSAT-2 satellite, which is going to be used for Earth observation, much like what NASA's Landsat program does. Now, launching rockets cheaply isn't all they're doing, though. They have an early version of a shuttle that they tested just last month that they hope will offer a reusable way for astronauts to get to and from space, just like NASA's space shuttle program used to do. And I will keep you posted. Finally, not to be outdone, last Saturday, China launched its next-generation booster rocket from the Wenchang Space Launch Center on Hainan Island in southern China. The Long March 7 rocket is 53 meters long, or 175 feet in length, can carry up to 13.5 tons into low Earth orbit, and it uses an environmentally friendly fuel that's made up of kerosene and liquid oxygen. It was originally intended for use on both manned and unmanned missions under the China Manned Space Program. And Saturday's launch was the first of a number of initial test flights before the rocket will be used for manned launches. The Long March rockets are a new family of rockets that include the Long March 7, which just tested Saturday and will carry payloads into low Earth orbit, the Long March 5, which is a heavy lift rocket system, and the Long March 6, which is a rocket that will launch small satellites into space. China also has manned space capsules they're calling Shenzhou, and they're based on the tried and tested Russian Soyuz design, and they're intended to serve the next generation of Chinese space stations, the first of which is expected to be ready as soon as 2022. The launch this month of the Long March 7 rocket is the first from the new Wenchang Satellite Launch Center, and it's a big step forward in China's space program. Well, that's it for this week, space fans. I hope you all have a great 4th of July weekend. Thanks to all of my SFN Patreon patrons. Reminder that our monthly hangout is coming up next week, and I'll send you a post on Patreon of the date and the time, sometime maybe Wednesday or Thursday of next week. And thanks to all of you for watching, and as always, keep looking up.